Let's talk today about digital audio transmission. How we distribute our audio data throughout a production system as binary, as digital. Now, it's important to understand that today, when I'm talking about digital transmission, I'm not talking about getting a file from your computer to another computer, like internet streaming or burning something onto a disk and copying it over. I'm talking about real-time transmission of audio in a production or performance environment. Why would we want to do this? Well, I talked previously about the conversion process from taking something that's analog and turning it into digital through digital sampling. If I want to send this digital audio to another system, maybe a digital effects unit or something, I could convert it back into analog and then redigitize it, but then I'm doing another process of digital sampling. And once again, every process we apply to a signal, the more possibilities we have to lose fidelity, lose its faithfulness to the original sound. Sending audio from one digital system to another as analog introduces conversions that might not be necessary. So, if we can transmit digital data as digital data, we may achieve a higher fidelity. Analog transmission is easy. We're sending voltages down a wire, but it's pretty straightforward. Digital transmission, however, is going to be a little bit more complicated. While in some cases we're still going to be using wires, we're using those wires to transmit bits and bytes, ones and zeros. And it's important to understand that different ways of transmitting audio have different capabilities. They'll have a different number of maximum channels, a different maximum sample rate and bit depth, and even a different maximum cable length. One digital transmission format that's important for engineers to know is AES/EBU, Audio Engineering Society and the European Broadcast Union. They look like analog XLR cables, but they're cables for transmitting digital information. Each connection can handle two channels of sound at up to 192 kHz and maximum bit depth of 24 bits. The maximum recommended cable length is 100 meters, and beyond that you run the possibility of errors. Now, even if you're not a professional and haven't seen these AES/EBU cables, more than likely you've done some digital transmission of sound at the consumer level, either by using a Toslink cable, like for the optical out of your TV, or, more likely, an HDMI cable. Now, of course, usually the HDMI cable is transmitting the video simultaneously, but it's important to understand that the audio traveling along this cable is digital. An HDMI cable can transmit up to 8 channels of uncompressed audio at up to 192 kHz, 24 bits. Now, as a consumer product, the maximum length is a little bit harder to talk about, but depending on the system, an HDMI cable might lose its signal beyond 13 meters, and rarely do they go beyond 5 meters. For professionals, also worth noting is audio over Ethernet, so this is network audio, with, at the time of this video, the most well-known company being Dante. This can send up to 1,024 channels of 192 kHz audio at 32 bits, and can be useful for sending digital audio, for example, from a concert hall to a control room or a nearby studio. So, again, if we transmit this digital data as digital data without doing any conversion, we may achieve higher fidelity. But digital transmission is not immune to error. One significant problem we need to be aware of is jitter, which is irregularities in the timing of samples. Again, we've sampled our amplitudes at evenly spaced intervals, in the case of a CD, 44,100 times a second, and in an ideal world, these samples would all be occurring at precise divisions of that second. Those divisions are accomplished in a digital system with a word clock. So a word clock is a device that provides the timing for digital sampling in analog to digital conversion, digital to analog conversion, and digital transmission. So whether you're doing your digital sampling, converting those digital samples back to audio, or sending to another digital system, your word clock is determining that timing. So, to avoid jitter, these irregularities that might cause some distortion of our sound, first, we want a good word clock, and secondly, we want a single word clock to coordinate the timings of this sampling across our systems. So again, if I'm sending out to a digital reverb, I want that reverb to have the same timing as the audio interface that I'm sending out to it with, to avoid these two clocks being out of sync. Now, professional studios will likely have a standalone word clock, a hardware device that's responsible for all the timings in the system, but in a small studio or a home studio, audio interfaces provide the word clock. And if we're recording to our computer without an audio interface, our computer is providing the word clock internally. So, even after the recording process, it's important for us to be aware of what we're doing in the transmission of audio, whether we're transmitting it digitally or analog, and once again, allow these ideas to inform us to make the best choices in terms of fidelity.